Napoleon Bonaparte, born on the small island of Corsica, is one of the most famous men to have ever lived, hailed as the man of the 19th century. Even his very name is used as a word to describe something momentous, colossal, Napoleonic. A rags-to-riches story, Napoleon was only 24 years old when he became a general, and 35 when he crowned himself Emperor of the French. Charismatic leader of men, shrewd politician, and a military genius, Napoleon fought 60 battles in his career and only lost 7 of them, making him the most victorious general in history. Not since the days of ancient Rome and the Caesars had one man conquered so much of Europe, or held so much power. As a ruler of France and its empire for nearly 15 years, Napoleon was also a reformer and improver. He played a leading role in solidifying the gains and ideals of the French Revolution, promoting equality and careers open to talent, securing religious freedom and tolerance, ending aristocratic and feudal privilege, and founding the Civil Code, a unified and progressive code of laws, which are still in use across Europe to this day. Napoleon's empire helped provide the basis of what is today the European Union. For this reason, Napoleon is often considered the father of modern Europe, and ever since him, the world was never really the same. To this day, Napoleon remains one of the most written about men in history, second only to Jesus Christ. Inspiring masterpieces of music, art, literature, and poetry, from Beethoven's stirring Third Symphony to Tolstoy's War and Peace, few fictional characters have ever done as much as Napoleon Bonaparte. The so-called man of destiny and a mass of contradictions, Napoleon is still something of an enigma, both a hopeless romantic idealist and the bitterest of cynics. The combination of his irresistible charm when he chose to deploy it, his iron will, workaholic habits, inspirational speeches and sayings, sheer intellect, and of course his fiery temperament, captivated or alarmed. To some he was a god, to others the Antichrist. And his meteoric rise and then crushing downfall has been compared to a Greek tragedy. After less than 15 years in power, in the last of 7 wars formed against him by coalitions of European monarchs, Napoleon was finally defeated at the Battle of Waterloo and exiled to the remote rocky island of St. Helena in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. At the end of his life, reflecting on his misfortunes, Napoleon's analysis was, "I have too much ambition and a spirit of fire." This is the story of Napoleon and the dawn of a new age. Napoleon's conquest of Italy, and later of Egypt, made him a household name, cementing his self-belief and his powers of leadership. Most crucially of all, Napoleon was to take his first steps into diplomacy and European politics, founding states and toppling thrones, forging constitutions and exporting French revolutionary ideas. His early conquests paved the way for the foundation and character of his later rule and French Empire. Napoleon's Italian campaign was his debut on the world stage. Taking command of a ragged army devoid of hope and transforming it into a victorious fighting force, which in less than 1 year would defeat no less than 6 successive enemy armies, despite the French being constantly outnumbered. On what most consider to have been a secondary front, 26-year-old General Bonaparte has just launched a lightning campaign across northern Italy, defeating Piedmont and driving the Austrians across Lombardy. By the end of May, Napoleon was the master of that region and was about to enter Milan in triumph. The whole Italian peninsula resounded with the name of Bonaparte, but Napoleon had to sustain his brilliant luck and preserve the glory he had so quickly acquired. Before a second huge Austrian army arrived to try to drive him out of Italy for good, Napoleon needed to secure political stability in the country, dealing with revolt and the intrigues of various Italian states, as well as his own government, the Directory. on the 15th of May, just as Napoleon had predicted to the directors, Milan, the home of the Lombard kings, threw open its massive gates to the French armies. Just 1 month after the opening of the campaign at Montenotte, Napoleon himself entered Milan. A triumphal arch had been built in homage of the conqueror, and practically the whole population had marched out to welcome him and the French army, who were covered with flowers and received with joy, according to one witness. According to Stendhal, the sound of cheering filled the air. The prettiest women came to the windows. On the evening of that beautiful day, the French army and the people of Milan were friends. Although Napoleon was cheered loudly as he rode through the streets, he understood that conquerors always tended to be welcomed into the cities they were about to occupy. A militia called the National Guard was immediately organized under the command of one of the greatest noblemen of the city, the Duke of Serbelloni. Its uniforms were blue, red and white, in honor of the tricolor flag. A Milanese delegation humbly brought the young conqueror the keys to the city. "I hear you've got men under arms," Napoleon said sharply to one of them. "Just 300 men to keep order," the Italian replied. "They're not real soldiers like yours." A piece of flattery which made Napoleon smile despite himself. The bedraggled appearance of the French soldiers, fresh from battle, amused the observers. There was a striking contrast between the luxury of the Milanese and the grotesque attire of the French. When he reached Milan, a handsome officer, Robert, was invited to dinner by a marchioness. Although he dressed himself with great care, his shoes were so worn out from marching that they no longer had soles, and he had to fasten the top together with well-blackened cords. He was so embarrassed that the servants, dressed in magnificent livery, would detect his poverty, that he tipped them with a 6-franc piece, all the money he had in the world. Still, soldiers did not tend to join the armed forces in those days, expecting to be well provided for, but because the alternative in a provincial village or an urban gutter was worse. But if the Republic's soldiers were dressed like the dregs of humanity, barefooted, without bread, deaf to cowardly alarms, all marched to glory with the same step, they fought like Caesar's legions in Gaul. While the bells pealed from the 1,000-pinnacled cathedral and the crowds cheered, Napoleon took up residence in the palace from which the Austrian Archduke had just fled after making millions from hoarded corn. One prankster had put a placard on the front of the palace, which read, "This house to let. For the keys, apply to the French commissioner." At a state dinner given in his honour, at which 200 dishes were served, speaking in Italian, Napoleon promised the people of Milan the eternal friendship of France. The Milanese greeted the French as their liberators. Thought has become free, so it was said, and a tree of liberty was planted in the main city square, amid shouts of "Hurrah for liberty! Long live the Republic!" The same day, Napoleon's friend and aide-de-camp Marmont wrote to his father, "Dear father, we are today in Milan. Our triumphal entry recalled the entrance of the ancient Roman generals into Rome, when they had deserved well of the country. Milan is a very fine city, large and populous. Its inhabitants are thoroughly devoted to the French, and it is impossible to express all the signs of affection they have given us. It is easy to forget all the fatigues of a war as hot as this has been, when victory is our reward. Our successes are really incredible. They make General Bonaparte's name forever famous, and it is perfectly clear that we owe them to him. Anyone else in his place would have been beaten, and he has gone on simply from one triumph to another. This campaign is the finest and most brilliant that has ever been known. It ought to be recorded and read. It is full of instruction, and those who can understand it will get great profit from it. Such, dear father, is a faithful picture of our situation." That evening, Napoleon asked him, "Well, Marmont, what do you suppose people are saying about us in Paris? Are they satisfied?" "They must be filled with admiration for you." "They haven't seen anything yet. There are still greater successes for us in the future. Fortune has not smiled on us today, for me to despise her favours. She is a woman, and the more she does for me, the more I shall demand of her. In our time, no one has the slightest conception of what is great. It is up to me to show them." Napoleon was invited to stay at the Duke of Serbelloni's palazzo, which had 30 indoor servants and 100 staff in the kitchen. However, he needed them, because Napoleon began to entertain on a lavish scale, receiving writers, editors, artists, aristocrats, scientists, intellectuals, sculptors, and opinion formers, and reveling in Milan's opera, art, and architecture. there was a political purpose to all this. Wishing to be seen as an enlightened liberator, rather than just the latest in a long line of conquerors, Napoleon held out the hope of an eventually independent, unified nation-state, and so kindled the sparks of Italian nationalism. The day after Napoleon's arrival in Milan, he declared the creation of the Lombard Republic, and went on to conciliate or outwit the nobles and clergy outraged at the introduction of French ideas. This republic would be governed by pro-French Jacobins, and Napoleon encouraged political clubs to mushroom throughout the region. The one held in Milan soon included 800 lawyers and merchants. He also abolished the Austrian governing institutions, reformed Pavia University, held temporary municipal elections, founded a national guard, and thorough military discipline of the militia in all parts of Lombardy. He also conferred with the leading advocate of Italian unification, Francesco Melzi, to whom he handed over as much power as possible. In 1796, Italy was merely a geographical expression, a notion more than a nation. Despite its shared culture and slowly developing common language, it was divided into a number of small kingdoms, dukedoms, and oligarchic republics. Italians such as Melzi, who dreamed of a unified state, had no alternative but to place their hopes in the French, despite their demands for financial contributions, which added up, overall, to over 20 million francs. With the resources now at his disposal, Napoleon clothed his troops in new uniforms, filled the army chests, organized hospitals and large military stores, sent 1 million francs back to the Directory in Paris, and forwarded 250,000 francs to General Moreau, who, also with an impoverished army, was fighting against superior forces of Austrians on the Rhine. The troops were very happy at Milan. They had plenty of good bread and meat to eat, and good wine to drink. They, who had so long been without shoes, were now well fed and well equipped. What is more, they had been paid. "When I saw 60 francs, I thought myself rich," reminisced one officer. "It was the first time since 1793 that we received cash," recalled Captain Rougeau. And for several days, the army luxuriated in comforts it had not known for years. Napoleon's generals were certainly enjoying themselves. Though Napoleon took what steps he could to limit looting, his peers were brazenly making their fortunes at the expense of the conquered, with some, like Massena, taking greed to outrageous limits. By the end of this campaign, he had built up a vast fortune by extorting some unknown town or terrified civilian. Napoleon would later make him give up millions of francs. However, it was common practice at that period for commanders to handsomely reward themselves. The Duke of Wellington, who at this time was campaigning in India, left that country having paid off all his debts and amassed a fortune equivalent to £4 million today, all of it perfectly legally. Napoleon could easily have accumulated millions for his own private fortune. His friends urged him to do so, warning him that the Directory, jealous of his growing fame and power, would be more likely to try to crush than reward him. But Napoleon turned a deaf ear to all suggestions. Of course, he was probably also aware that if he pocketed funds, he would lose his moral ascendancy, and it was something the Directory would be able to get him on. So Napoleon would return to Paris from this brilliant campaign with relatively modest means. Napoleon later said, "Everyone has his relative ideas. I have a taste for founding, not for possessing. My riches consist in glory and fame." As for other temptations, it is beyond all doubt that Napoleon remained faithful to Josephine throughout the first campaign in Italy, despite the opportunities. Two of the most celebrated and beautiful women in Italy had hurried to greet the French conquerors, Madame Grassini and Madame Visconti. Everyone knew that the incomparably beautiful Madame Grassini, whose singing in the opera was applauded to the echo every night at La Scala, was nurturing a great passion for General Bonaparte and was bent on seducing him. All the French officers were head over heels for her, especially entranced with her way of speaking, a mixture of French and Italian, under the cover of which she used to get away with delivering some startling statements. But Napoleon remained immune to her charms. The socialite Madame Visconti had already captured the heart of Paris when she visited that summer, and was also ambitious of seducing Napoleon, but the commander-in-chief would have none of her. Instead, she settled for second best. Berthier, who was second in command, had fallen desperately in love with her at first sight, and she became his mistress. The affair would last so long that it became a standing joke in the army. Berthier became obsessed by her, and his liaison with Madame Visconti, which Napoleon used to call Berthier's folly, endured until his death. The commander-in-chief was perhaps the only man who appeared indifferent to pleasure, one eyewitness of the time noted. However, Napoleon later admitted that it was not simply high moral principles that curbed him, it was partly dictated by policy. I was too strong-minded to let myself fall into the snare. Beneath the flowers I gorged the precipice. My position was most delicate. I had under me generals much older than myself. My task was an enormous one, and everything I did was jealously watched by all. My circumspection was extreme. My success or failure depended upon my behaviour. I could have let my caution slumber for one brief hour, but how many of my victories have depended on no longer time than that? My extreme youth, when I took command of the army of Italy, made it necessary for me to evince great reserve of manners and the utmost severity of morals. This was indispensable to allow me to sustain authority over men so greatly superior in age and experience. I pursued a line of conduct in the highest degree irreproachable and exemplary. In spotless morality, I was a Cato, and I must have appeared such to all. I was a philosopher and a sage. My supremacy could be retained only by proving myself a better man than any other in the army. Had I yielded to human weaknesses, I should have lost my power. As a result, Napoleon, alone of all his generals, was miserable. Josephine had still not come to join him. She was, she said, too unwell to travel. As Marmont put it, he thought ceaselessly about his wife. He desired her, he awaited her with impatience. He spoke frequently of her and of his love, with the effusion, ardour, and the delusions of a very young man. His love letters to her at this time are a case in point. I have not spent a day without loving you. I have not spent a night without holding you in my arms. I have not drunk a cup of tea without cursing the glory and ambition which keep me from the heart of my very being. In the midst of my activities, whether at the head of my troops or inspecting the camps, my adorable Josephine stands alone in my heart. She occupies my mind and fills my thoughts. If I depart from you with the speed of the rushing roan, it is only so that I may see you again more quickly. If I get up in the middle of the night to work, it is because this may hasten by some days the arrival of my sweet love. Yet, in your letter of the 23rd and of the 26th Fontos, you address me as vous yourself. Ah, wretched woman, how could you have written this letter? It is so cold. And then there are those 4 days, between the 23rd and the 26th. What were you doing, because you were not writing to your husband? Ah, my love, that vous and those 4 days make me long for my former indifference. Woe to the person responsible. May that person, as punishment and suffering, experience what my conviction and the evidence that he is that person's friend make me experience. Hell has no torments great enough, nor the fury serpents. Vous, ah, what will it be in 2 weeks? My spirit is heavy, my heart is in chains, and I am appalled by my imaginings. You love me less, but you will recover. One day you will no longer love me, say it. I shall then know how to be worthy of this misfortune. Farewell, wife, torment, joy, hope, and heart of my being, whom I love and fear, and who inspires in me gentle emotions, which draw me close to nature, and violent impulses as volcanic as Etna. I ask of you neither eternal love nor fidelity, but simply truth, unlimited honesty. The day when you say, I love you less, will either be the end of my love or the last day of my life. If my heart were base enough to love without being loved in return, I would tear it to pieces with my teeth. Josephine, remember what I have sometimes said to you. Nature has made me strong and decisive. She has made you out of lace and gossamer. Do you love me no longer? Forgive me, love of my life. My heart is racked by conflicting forces. Obsessed by you, my heart is full of fears, which make me unhappy. I am distressed not to be calling you by name. I shall wait for you to write it. Farewell. Ah, if you love me less, you can never have loved me. In that case, I shall truly be pitiable. P.S. The war is completely changed this year. My soldiers are showing inexpressible confidence in me. You alone are a source of chagrin to me. You alone are the joy and torment of my life. I send a kiss to your children, whom you do not mention. By God, if you did, it would make your letters longer, and then the 10 o'clock in the morning visitors would not have the pleasure of seeing you. Woman! On the 6th of May, Napoleon went on a trip to inspect military placements. According to his friend and aide-de-camp, Marmont, he was in an anxious mood. The delays that Josephine threw in the way of departure tormented him terribly. Napoleon reached into his pocket, as he did many times during the day, to take out and kiss his miniature portrait of Josephine, but he discovered that the portrait's glass was cracked and had shattered. Corsicans are more superstitious than most. According to Marmont, his face grew pale in a terrifying way, his manner became extremely agitated, and the impression of deep sadness descended around him. "Marmont," he said, "my wife is either very ill, or she is being unfaithful." And he succumbed to an outburst of anxiety and superstition, which was strong in his nature. But then, in late May, the Directory wrote to Napoleon, making it clear that they had previously tried to prevent Josephine from joining him in Italy. "It is with great reluctance that we yield to the desire of citoyenne Bonaparte to join you. We were afraid that the attention you would give her would distract you from attending to the glory and safety of your country. Hence, we have long resisted her wishes." This had the effect of reassuring Napoleon. But still, he continued to hear hardly anything from Josephine. So Napoleon sent two of his trusted aides to Paris, first Junot, and then Murat, with a fateful question: "There's no one else, is there?" Arriving in Paris, Murat tried to discover from Josephine whether she was involved with someone else. She denied this, claiming she was ill, but the symptoms she reported were suspiciously similar to pregnancy, and this is what she may have said or insinuated to Murat. When he heard this news, Napoleon was about to enter Milan, and now his triumph seemed complete. He wrote to her ecstatically, "I do not know why I am so happy this morning. I have a feeling that you have left to come here. This idea fills me with joy. Of course, you will pass through Piedmont, which is a much better and shorter way. You will come to Milan, where you will be very happy. This country is very beautiful. As for me, it will make me so happy that I will be mad. I'm dying to see how you bear children. It must give you a majestic, respectable look that seems to me will be very pleasant, especially if you are not going to be ill. No, sweet love, you will come here, you will bear very well, and soon will give life to a being who will love you as much as its father. And when you are old, when you are 100, it will be your consolation and your joy. Your children and I, we shall always be around to convince you of our care and love. You will never be cross, will you? No humps, except for fun. Then three or four faces. Nothing is prettier. And then a little kiss patches up everything. Come quickly to hear good music and see beautiful Italy. There is nothing lacking to it except the sight of you." Then Napoleon received a brief note from Josephine, saying she was ill and had three doctors attending to her. As usual, Napoleon turned to his older brother, Joseph, who was then in Paris, writing to him, "I am in despair, my brother. My wife, the creature I love best in the world, is ill. My brain reels at the thought. The darkest forebodings oppress me. I implore you to tell me exactly how she is, what there is to fear. I beseech you, by our brotherhood, by the tender affection there has always been between us since our childhood, watch over her, tend her as I should be proud to do myself. You cannot bring my heart to the task, but you, and you alone, can in some measure take my place. You are the only man in the world for whom I have a true and lasting affection. After her, after my Josephine, you hold the first place in my heart. Comfort me, tell me the truth. You know me, you know my passionate nature. You know too that Josephine is the only woman I have ever really loved. The thought of her illness drives me to distraction. No one writes to me, all have forsaken me. Even you do not write. I am alone with my fears, my misery. If she is better and can safely undertake the journey, I long unspeakably to have her with me. I want to see her, to hold her in my arms. I love her so madly, I cannot live without her. If she were to die, there would be nothing left for me to do on this earth. Oh, my good brother, I rely on you. See that my messenger remains no more than 6 hours in Paris, and send him back with new life to me." Napoleon felt that he had to see her, but the directors refused him compassionate leave. He was not going to enrich their coffers by playing the lovesick swain in Josephine's boudoir. The only way Napoleon could see Josephine was if she herself came to him. Napoleon had accomplished the first two acts of the drama set him, peace with Piedmont and the conquest of Milan. There remained Act 3, decisive victory over the Austrians, and with that victory, peace. But amidst these successes, Napoleon received a letter from the Directory, the most painful letter he had ever received in his life. By this time, the Directory in Paris were growing alarmed with the public admiration that was starting to concentrate dangerously around Napoleon, especially after the lackluster performances of Generals Moreau and Jourdan in Germany. In one short month, Napoleon had filled Europe with his name. Therefore, the directors told Napoleon that he was to give up sole command of the Army of the Alps and to share the glory of the campaign. From then onwards, the army was to be under joint command of both General Bonaparte and General Kellerman. Kellerman was to continue fighting the Austrians in the north, while Napoleon was to undertake a new campaign in the south against the Papal States and Tuscany, who were both friendly towards Austria. Napoleon knew Kellerman to be a haughty man, a sound commander, but at 61, slow in setting his ways. Yet because he was senior to Napoleon, and a well-established household name, Kellerman would inevitably have the final say on all matters. Having only just achieved high command, Napoleon did not relish having to serve under a man less eager and daring than himself. Napoleon strongly objected to their proposal. "Citizen directors, I believe it most impolitic to divide the army of Italy into two sections. It is contrary to the interests of the Republic to put two generals in command. The expedition against Livorno, Rome and Naples is a small affair. It can be accomplished by arranging the divisions in echelon in such a manner as to enable them, by a retrograde march, to appear in force against the Austrians and threaten to hem them in, at the slightest movement on their part. For this, it is not only necessary to have one general, but it is also essential that he should have nothing to hinder him during his march or in his operations. I have conducted the campaign without consulting anyone. I would have accomplished nothing of worth had I been forced to reconcile my ideas with those of another. I have gained some advantages over very superior forces, while in an almost destitute condition, because, persuaded of your entire confidence in me, my movements were as prompt as my thoughts. If you fetter me on all sides, if it is necessary for me to confer with the government commissioners regarding each step, if they have the right to change my movements, to send me troops or withdraw them at their will, then look for no good. If you weaken your means by dividing your forces, if you break the unity of the military outline in Italy, with grief I tell you that you will have lost the most favourable occasion for bringing Italy to terms. In the present condition of the affairs of the Republic in Italy, it is indispensable for you to have a general in whom you have entire confidence. If it is not I, then I make no complaint. I shall only strive to redouble my zeal in order to merit your esteem in the post that you have confided to me. Everyone has his own manner of making war. General Kellerman would command the army as well as myself, for no one could be more convinced than I that our victories are due to the courage and dash of the army. But I think that to give Kellerman and myself joint command in Italy would mean ruining everything. I can't agree to serve with a man who believes himself the best general in Europe, and in any case, I'm sure that one bad general is better than two good ones. War, like government, is a question of tact. Your decision on this matter is of more importance than the 15,000 men the Emperor of Austria has sent to Beaulieu." Napoleon also saw another side to this matter. In an order of the day issued back in Nice, Napoleon had assured his troops that they could count on Paris backing him and them to the full, and that they would not be let down for political reasons. And now it seemed they were being let down. In a second letter, Napoleon wrote to the directors, "I cannot give my country the service it sorely needs without being invested with your absolute and entire confidence. I am aware that it requires much courage to write you this letter. It would be so easy to accuse me of ambition or pride." Napoleon privately told Barras, "I will resign. Nature has given me a lot of character, along with some talents. I cannot be useful here unless I have your full confidence." And described Kellerman, the victor of the Battle of Valmy, as a German for whose tone and principles I have no respect. Napoleon was right that the two men would soon have clashed, and the campaign had so far proved that a single commander-in-chief had a major advantage over the unwieldy Austrian command structure. The directors considered Napoleon's answers. Doubtless they were nettled by his obstinacy, but they could not help but be impressed by his arguments. Moreover, the hint that he would resign after such a string of victories must have weighed heavily on them. So they decided to scrap the idea of joint command. Napoleon was to remain sole commander, but in that case, he must single-handedly carry out the two tasks they had originally proposed. Napoleon knew that if he continued to win battles, he would have the upper hand over the Directory, to whom he continued to pay proper public obedience, but which he was increasingly coming to despise. After resting for several days, the French army was now ready to resume its pursuit of the Austrians east. As usual, Napoleon's speeches to his troops never failed to inspire and motivate them. Eloquent, prophetic, they abounded in phrases which the soldiers never forgot. Soldiers, you have rushed like a torrent from the summit of the Apennines. You have overthrown and scattered all that opposed your march. Piedmont, delivered from Austrian tyranny, indulges her natural sentiments of peace and friendship towards France. Milan is yours, and the Republican flag waves throughout Lombardy. The Dukes of Parma and Modena owe their political existence to your generosity alone. The army which so haughtily threatened you can find no barrier to protect itself against your courage. The Po, the Ticino, and the Adda have been unable to arrest your courage for a single day. These vaunted fortifications of Italy opposed you in vain. You have surmounted them as rapidly as the Apennines. These great successes have filled the heart of your country with joy. Your representatives have ordered a festival to commemorate your victories, which has been held in every district of the French Republic. There, your fathers, your wives, sisters, and mistresses rejoiced in your good fortune and proudly boasted of belonging to you. Yes, soldiers, you have done much, but remains there nothing more to do? Shall it be said of us that we know how to conquer, but not how to make use of our victory? Shall posterity reproach us with having found a Capua in Lombardy? You have accomplished nothing unless you finish what remains to be done. Are there any among you whose courage is flagging? No. But I see you already hasten to arms. An effeminate response is tedious to you. The days which are lost to glory are lost to your happiness. Well then, let us set forth. We still have forced marches to make, enemies to subdue, laurels to gather, and injuries to avenge. Let those who have sharpened the daggers of civil war in France, who have basely murdered our ministers and burnt our ships at Toulon, tremble. The hour of vengeance has struck, but let the people of all countries be free from apprehension. We are the friends of the people everywhere, particularly the descendants of Brutus and Scipio, and those great men whom we have taken for our models. To restore the capital, to replace with honour the statues of the heroes who rendered it illustrious, to rouse the Roman people, stupefied by several ages of slavery, shall be, will be, the fruit of your victories. They will form an era for posterity. You will have the immortal glory of changing the fate of the finest part of Europe. The French people, free and respected by the whole world, will give to Europe a glorious peace, which will compensate them for the sacrifice of every kind, which for the last 6 years they have been making. You will then return to your homes and your country. Men will say as they point to you, he belonged to the army of Italy. On the 22nd of May, Napoleon left Milan in pursuit of the Austrians. He had hardly marched one day when a formidable revolt broke out. Supporters of republicanism were, for the most part, in the cities. But the rural peasantry tended to be strongly attached to the church. The Catholic priests, encouraged by the Pope, incited the peasants to rise up and exterminate the French. For Pope Pius VI, the French Revolution was above all directed against the Catholic Church, and he had watched uneasily as the French army occupied Piedmont and Lombardy. He did not know that Napoleon firmly intended to respect religion, nor, more importantly, that he was strong enough to oppose the Directory, who was seeking to overthrow the papacy. The rebels rang the alarm bell in every church, calling on the people to revolt. In one day, 30,000 peasants grasped their weapons. The revolt centered in Pavia, and the next day, riots broke out in Milan too. Napoleon knew that he did not have a moment to lose. He quickly turned back, taking with him 1,200 men and 6 cannons. In Milan, order is quickly re-established. But on the road to Pavia, Napoleon came across 800 of the rebels holed up in the village of Benasco. There was no parleying, and the veteran French troops rushed into the town with their bayonets and sabres, killing 100 of them. The torch was applied to the town, and thick billows of smoke proclaimed far and wide over the Italian plains how dreadful a thing it was to incur the wrath of a conqueror. A week after Banasco, Napoleon told the Directory, "Although necessary, this spectacle was nevertheless horrible. I was painfully affected by it." 10 years later, Napoleon would write, "Remember Banasco. It brought me tranquillity in all of Italy, and spared shedding the blood of thousands. Nothing is more salutary than appropriately severe examples." In Napoleon's opinion, if you make war, wage it with energy and severity. It is the only way of making it shorter, and consequently less deplorable for mankind. Napoleon and his troops then swept on, arriving at the gates of Pavia, the headquarters of the rebels, which had 30,000 inhabitants. Napoleon had left a garrison of 300 men there, but the rebels had managed to throw themselves into the city, prepared for a desperate resistance. First, Napoleon sent the Archbishop of Milan in with a flag of truce, offering pardon to all who would lay down their weapons. Napoleon declared, "May the terrible example of Banasco open your eyes. Its fate shall be that of every town which persists in revolt." But the rebels were defiant. "While Pavia has walls, we will not surrender." Napoleon then ordered his artillery to sweep the ramparts with grapeshot, while his soldiers tried to break down the gates, and they rushed into the city like a wave. By now, the French troops had worked themselves up into a fury, believing that the garrison that had been left there must have been massacred by the rebels. As Napoleon was about to pursue the Austrians far into the mountains of the Tyrol, it seemed necessary that, by a firm example, he had to teach those who he left behind that they could not rise against them with impunity. And so Napoleon gave the orders that Pavia was to be handed over to pillage for 24 hours. While in Pavia during the sacking, probably to distract himself from what was going on outside, Napoleon visited its famous university in a very tetchy mood. "What class is this?" Napoleon asked as he entered the first room. When told it was metaphysics, Napoleon, who had little confidence in this abstract subject, exclaimed, "Bah!" and took a pinch of snuff. Turning to one of the pupils, he asked, "What is the difference between sleep and death?" The unsure pupil turned to the professor for help, the famous Scarpa, who simply replied, "The dead one doesn't wake up." The next class Napoleon entered was mathematics, and picking up a book from one of the tables, he gave one of the brightest pupils a very difficult problem to solve. Napoleon glanced over the student's answer and said, "You are wrong." The pupil insisted that he was right. Napoleon took the slate and sat down to work out the problem himself, saw his own mistake, and returning the slate, admitted, "Yes, yes, you are right." Napoleon then went into another class, where he met the celebrated Volta, the Newton of electricity. Delighted to meet him, Napoleon asked him to prolong the class for him. The university's president then made a speech to Napoleon, declaring, "Charlemagne laid the foundation of this university. May Napoleon the Great give it the completion of its glory." After leaving the university, it appears Napoleon had a change of heart about Pavia. "I promised that the soldiers should have it at their mercy for 24 hours, but after 3 hours, I could bear such scenes of outrage no longer and put an end to them. Policy and morality are equally opposed to the system. Nothing is so certain to disorganize and completely ruin an army." Napoleon declared to the inhabitants, "The order to lay the city in ashes was just leaving my lips. When the garrison of the castle arrived, their names were called over and none found missing. If the blood of a single Frenchman had been shed, my determination was to erect a column on the ruins of Pavia, bearing this inscription, 'Here stood the city of Pavia.'" Order was soon re-established, and Napoleon repeated his wish to respect and defend the Catholic religion. However, Napoleon was furious with the French garrison for allowing themselves to be made prisoners without even a fight. "Cowards! I entrusted you with a post essential to the safety of an army, and you have abandoned it to a mob of wretched peasants without offering the least resistance." He had the captain responsible delivered over to a council of war, who then court-martialed him, and he was thereby shot. In the countryside around Tortona, Napoleon destroyed all the church bells that had been used to summon the revolt, and hundreds of hostages were taken from prominent local families to ensure future cooperation. A score of the ringleaders were shot, and Napoleon had no hesitation in ordering the shooting of any village priest caught leading peasant bands. Although Napoleon's youthful anti-clericalism in Corsica was enough to make him resent what he called the canting priesthood. It was here once again confirmed by the way parish priests encouraged violent uprisings, yet this also instilled him with a respect for the power of the church, which he realized he could not wholly oppose. On the flip side, Napoleon also promised to protect peaceful priests who did not mix religion and politics. Napoleon's decisive retaliation crushed the revolt over the whole of Lombardy. The directors themselves approved of the severe measures. The laws of war and the safety of the army rendered them legitimate in such circumstances. A few days after pacifying Pavia, Napoleon arrived in Brescia on the 28th of May and issued a proclamation to his troops. It is to deliver the finest country in Europe from the iron yoke of the haughty House of Austria, that the French army has braved the most formidable obstacles. Victory, siding with justice, has crowned its efforts with success. The ruins of the enemy's army has retreated behind the Mincio River. In order to pursue them, the French army enters the territory of the Republic of Venice, but it will not forget that the two republics are united by an ancient friendship. Religion, government, and customs shall be respected. Let the people be free from trepidation. The severest army discipline will be kept up. Whatever the army is supplied with shall be punctually paid for in money. The General-in-Chief invites the officers of the Republic of Venice, the magistrates and the priests, to make known his sentiments to the people, in order that the friendship which has so long subsisted between the two nations may be cemented by confidence. Faithful in the path of honour, as in that of victory, the French soldier is terrible only to the enemies of his liberty and his government. Beaulieu had fled through the Venetian territories, and Napoleon had no choice but to follow him through them too. The Republic of Venice contained 3 million inhabitants. Its fleet ruled the Adriatic Sea, and it had an army of 50,000 men. The Venetians, though unfriendly to France, preferred neutrality. But Napoleon wanted them to declare themselves sure allies of France, as they had long had close ties to Austria. He declared to their envoys, "Venice has either given refuge to the Austrians, in which case it is the enemy of France, or it was unable to prevent the Austrians from invading its territory, and is, consequently, too weak to claim the right of neutrality." The Venetian government deliberated and still decided that they wanted to stay, supposedly neutral. They sent Napoleon 1.2 million francs as a bribe to secure his friendship, which he decisively rejected. To some of his aides, who said it was perfectly proper for him to receive this money, he replied, "If my commissary should see me accept this money, who can tell to what lengths he might go?" The Venetian envoys returned deeply impressed with Napoleon. They had expected to find only a stern soldier, and to their surprise, they met a budding statesman. They wrote to their Senate, "This extraordinary young man will one day exert great influence over his country." Napoleon resumed his advance east, his army now organized into 4 divisions. General Beaulieu's Austrian army held the line of the Mincio River, with Lake Garda on his right and the great fortress of Mantua on his left, into which he had thrown a garrison of 15,000 Austrians. This, together with the fortresses at Peschiera, Verona, and Lugnano, forms the famous quadrilateral, the 4 bastions that cemented Austria's grip on northern Italy. But once again, Beaulieu can't get a read on Napoleon's movements. He scattered his troops, trying to defend 4 potential crossing points, and was further distracted by fake preparations to cross Lake Garda by boat. In fact, Napoleon decided to cross the Mincio at Porchetto, and when Kilmaine's advance guard arrived, they found the bridge defended by a single battalion of infantry and a handful of hussars. Although the Austrians had partially demolished the bridge, they found themselves driven back from the river into the town of Valeggio, which the French quickly cleared. Just after this battle, on the 1st of June, Napoleon had a lucky escape. Feeling unwell that day, suffering from a severe migraine, Napoleon entered an old castle to see if a foot bath would help. He only had a small retinue with him, as his troops were pursuing the fleeing Austrians. Napoleon had just placed his feet in the water when he heard the clatter of horses' hooves in the courtyard. The guard at the door shouted, to arms, the Austrians!" Napoleon hastily put on one boot, and with the other in his hand, leapt from the window, escaped over several garden walls and through the back gate, mounted a horse, and chased by the Austrian cavalry, galloped to Massena's nearby division, who were busy cooking their dinner. At the sudden appearance of their commander-in-chief, the soldiers rushed to chase off the Austrians, who then retreated. This incident convinced Napoleon to form an elite cavalry corps to act as his personal bodyguard on campaign. Made up of 500 veterans, called guides, they were commanded by a young cavalry captain, Bessier. He was an old friend of Murat's, and a conscientious, clear-minded man, who was to quickly become one of Napoleon's most trusted friends. In time, this unit would become the famous Chasseurs à Cheval of the Imperial Guard, which later obtained such legendary status as Napoleon's most elite unit. Taken by surprise by the crossing at Borghetto, Bollier began a withdrawal to a new defensive line in the Adige Valley, abandoning 5,000 prisoners, his cannon and all his supplies. However, at Mantua, he managed to leave behind a reinforced garrison, well supplied, and ready to withstand a siege of at least 2 months. In 50 days, Napoleon had swept all but a remnant of the Austrians out of Italy. Taking up a strong position on the Adige River, Napoleon encamped his troops before the imposing fortress of Mantua, which had 20,000 Austrians cooped up in its garrison. The French could not bypass Mantua. The garrison inside was too strong and might attack them when their back was turned. To the French, capturing Mantua became the key to Italy. The fortress city was formidable, its old walls surrounded on three sides by a lake and on the other by marshland, which were to cause outbreaks of malarial fever amongst the French, making it the most unhealthy place in Italy, in Napoleon's words. It was accessible only by five long and narrow causeways, which were guarded by frowning batteries. As it was almost impossible to assault these defences, Napoleon was forced to resort to the more tedious operations of a siege, which he began on the 4th of July. Napoleon's biggest problem was his lack of heavy siege artillery. Indeed, more guns were supposed to have arrived by sea, but had been intercepted by British ships, commanded by a certain Commodore Horatio Nelson. Since April, Napoleon had launched three successful offensives, marched more than 200 miles, and won 10 battles. But finally, outside the walls of Mantua, Napoleon was brought to a halt. The French may have been victorious so far, but their position was precarious, and the demands on his limited force were growing. Napoleon had to maintain the siege of Mantua, even though its guns outnumbered his own, and no direct assault can be made. He also had to protect his lines of communication back to France, and guard against further revolt in northern Italy. At the beginning of June, Napoleon learned that Austria was preparing a huge new army, and was now marching south to drive Napoleon out of Italy once and for all. The Austrian government, dissatisfied with the generalship of Bullieu, replaced him with Marshal Wurmser, a Frenchman from Alsace, in the service of Austria, who had just left the Rhine with a huge Austro-Hungarian army of 60,000 men. True, Napoleon's own army had also been reinforced, but he only had 30,000 men to meet Wurmser's 60,000 men from the north, as well as the 20,000 garrisoned Austrians in Mantua. Moreover, between Napoleon and France lay a number of feeble Italian governments whose friendship could not be depended upon. The Papal States to the south were plotting. Naples was an ally of Austria. The Kingdom of Piedmont yearned for vengeance. Venice claimed she was neutral, but could not be trusted. The Grand Duke of Tuscany was an Austrian Archduke. Modena, Lucca and Parma were ruled by Austrian Dukes and Grand Dukes. Trento was being occupied by the Austrian army. The Republic of Genoa had its oligarchy in the pay of England, while the English themselves were just off the coast, and might at any moment strike up an alliance with any one of them and place a strong enemy on the French rear. It was clear that a single French failure would set all these petty princes on Napoleon's heels. The framework which Napoleon had built up could fall to the ground like a house of cards. So he set about trying to lessen these dangers. Although Napoleon had warned them that marching troops the length of Italy in high summer will end in sickness and death, the French Directory demanded that he lead an expedition into central and southern Italy to threaten military occupation. Napoleon calculated that the new Austrian commander Wurmser and his 60,000 men could not arrive in Italy until the 15th of July. That gave him 6 weeks to swoop down on the Papal States and Tuscany assure their neutrality, and collect what gold he could for France's empty coffers, which would also help fund the French war effort. If Napoleon had marched fast in the spring, then he marched even faster in the summer. After putting Massena in charge of guarding the north, Napoleon headed south with two divisions, one to Bologna, the other into Tuscany. Fortunately, strong words alone persuaded Naples, the most powerful state in Italy, to come to terms with the French. Seeing the Austrians driven out of every part of Italy except Mantua, the King of Naples sent envoys to Napoleon, asking for peace. Napoleon, not being able to march his army so far south to impose contributions, and yet eager to get Naples' army of 60,000 men off the field as his enemies, granted him an armistice with terms so moderate that it again annoyed the Directory. Napoleon also used this time to make peace with the Pope. Now abandoned by Naples, the Pope was in a tricky situation. He had denounced the French Revolution and supported, but not formally joined, the first coalition against France. And now, after the recent religious uprising in Pavia, the Directory reissued its order for Napoleon to destroy the papacy. But Napoleon, although not a believer himself, had respect for religion as an institution, and did not have the slightest intention of carrying out this order, which he knew would be an infamy. However, he knew that to obtain the support of the Catholic population, it was vital to reach a peace settlement with the Pope. He also knew that, given the priesthood's attitude towards revolutionary France, he could only get agreements by a display of actual force, however small that might be. He intended to occupy a few towns belonging to the papacy to get the Pope's attention and secure a peace treaty. Napoleon, taking with him just 6,000 men, entered the most northern part of the Papal States, Emilia-Romagna. The Pope had a weak army of no more than 5,000 men, which the French quickly scattered. His physical power was nothing. It was his spiritual power alone which made the Pope formidable. But in the end, Napoleon didn't even need to march as far as Rome. On the 20th of June, Napoleon entered Bologna, where the Pope sent him envoys to bargain on his behalf, and within a week, they were forced to come to terms. Napoleon granted the Pope an armistice, in which he exacted the surrender of Ancona, Bologna and Ferrara to a French garrison, a payment of 15 million francs in silver and gold that was enough to bring around the Directory, and the contribution of 100 paintings or statues and 500 ancient manuscripts from the Vatican Library, which were intended for the new art museum in Paris. The Pope, who had probably expected he would be overthrown, was content to escape with such terms. A few months later, Napoleon's eagle eye spotted that the library was trying to reduce its commitment, and he wrote to the French agent in Rome to point out that the treaty included 500 manuscripts, not 300. As for the other central Italian states, the Duchy of Tuscany had recognised the French Republic as legitimate, and did remain neutral in this conflict. However, the English, who were at war with France, were friendly trading partners of the Tuscan Grand Duke, and were currently in the port of Livorno, an important English commercial and banking enclave. At this time period, wherever England's fleets encountered a merchant ship of the enemy, it was seized as fair plunder. And Napoleon decided to retaliate in turn by capturing English property wherever his army encountered it on the land of the continent. Napoleon crossed the Apennines and by forced marches proceeded to Leghorn, where he captured ships and gold amounting to £12 million, though many English ships did manage to escape from the harbour before the French arrived. Napoleon sent Leghorn's hostile governor in a carriage to the Grand Duke of Tuscany with a message. The governor of Leghorn has violated all the rights of neutrality by oppressing French commerce and by affording an asylum to the émigrés and to all the enemies of the Republic. Out of respect to your authority, I send the unfaithful servant to be punished at your discretion. Napoleon also exacted a contribution from the Grand Duke for having given English merchants trading privileges at Leghorn. In such a way, any neutral states were taught that they must firmly respect their neutrality. It was here that Napoleon also equipped 500 Corsican refugees and organised an expedition which by the end of the year was to wrest Corsica from the English and make the island once again French. But otherwise, Napoleon never really showed much interest or favour towards the island of his birth. As Sir Walter Scott put it, he was like the young lion who, while he is scattering the herds and destroying the hunters, thinks little of the forest cave in which he first saw the light. Napoleon left a French garrison at Leghorn, and then arrived in Florence, the capital of Tuscany, on the 1st of July, where the streets, from San Frediano to the Pitti Palace gates, were filled with crowds trying to catch a glimpse of him. Napoleon went to view the gorgeous Pietro da Cortona ceiling paintings commissioned by the Medici, as well as paintings by Rubens, Raphael, Titian, Van Dyck and Rembrandt, which could be easily removed to Paris. Napoleon also visited the Tuscan Grand Duke in the palace on the Boboli Gardens, where Napoleon told him in no uncertain terms, "Your brother no longer has a foot of land in Lombardy," which was not strictly true, as Mantua was still being occupied by Austrians who were under siege. But although the Grand Duke maintained his composure, he knew that its fall might be followed by the loss of his throne. By the 13th of July, Napoleon was back in Milan, having marched 300 miles in under 6 weeks, cowed all France's enemies in central Italy, and seized 40 million francs in booty and indemnities for the penniless French government. And so by the time General Wurmser and his fresh army of 60,000 Austrians were ready to fight, Italy had been calmed and stabilized. When he returned to Milan, Napoleon was also overjoyed to find a long-awaited visitor, Josephine.